Cantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Most Dope, The Extraordinary Life of Mac Miller, by Paul Cantor, narrated by Paul Cantor. For my wife and daughter, my extended family, and most importantly, you. Author's note. In 2009, long before anyone really knew who Mac Miller was, I received a message from a gentleman named Arthur Pitt, who was working as a publicist for an up-and-coming independent record label out of Pittsburgh called Rostrum Records. The label was the brainchild of Benji Grinberg, a former assistant to legendary record exec L.A. Reid, and had endured some early struggles with an artist they were trying to break. His name was Wiz Khalifa. Very early in Wiz's career, August of 2006, I interviewed the baby-faced rapper for a short profile that was to run in a forthcoming issue of XXL magazine, at the time, hip-hop's most important publication. Capable of minting stars overnight, XXL was initially enthusiastic about Wiz, but after my article was written, they changed their mind and declined to publish. He just wasn't popular enough yet. But there I was that day, some years later, sitting alone in my Staten Island apartment, when my AOL instant messenger alerted me to a new message from Arthur, who most everyone colloquially referred to as Artie. Rostrum had gone to the mat with Wiz, and after numerous independent releases and a botched deal for him with Warner Brothers Records, Wiz was beginning to experience real success. Artie wanted me to check out a new artist he was working with. He sent me a YouTube clip. In it, a young rapper, a white kid no less, sat with the camera close to his face, freestyling aggressively in a pained effort to impress anyone who might be watching. "I'm thinking of working with this kid," Artie said. "Tell me what you think." Back then, I was already half a decade into writing about rap music. With a popular blog that I penned on XXL's website, and freelance work for outlets like Vibe, Complex, and MTV, to say nothing of my work as an aspiring record producer, music industry people were always asking me to check something or someone out. A tough critic who had been a hip-hop obsessive since the early 90s, I was often let down by what I heard or saw, and I expected very little from what Artie had sent me. I considered Artie a friend, and I liked Wiz Khalifa, but I wasn't terribly impressed with some of the newer artists Artie was working with. That day, though, when I pressed play, I immediately thought the rapper before me, Mac Miller, had bars that, at a time when being super lyrical was not trendy, he was clearly an above-average lyricist using the most time-honored tool of the hip-hop trade, the freestyle, to make his name known. Moreover, there was a kernel of something there. He was young, still in high school, but you could see a spark, the undeniable and indefinable it factor that the music industry is built on. I told Artie he should work with him, and while I'm certain I wasn't the only person he consulted for advice, he wisely decided to do so. Unlike Wiz, Mac took off quickly. It seemed that as soon as Rostrum began working with him, he was everywhere. I couldn't help but feel that so much of the work the label had done with Wiz had helped Mac out. In the end, though, a label was only as good as the artist on its roster. And Mac was an unbelievable talent. He could write, produce, perform, and so much more. But even that is often not enough to turn someone into a star, let alone a legend. What set Mac apart, I think, is that he was genuinely interested and enthusiastic, perhaps to an unhealthy degree, about what he did. He seemed to be unflinchingly nice and charismatic, a genuine human who endeared himself to everyone he met. But the thing that made him truly great, the thing that allows his name to echo from this generation to the next and beyond, is that he just wanted it more. He wasn't afraid or embarrassed or too cool to say he wanted to be great. And he didn't just want to be great for himself. He wanted to be great for you, for me, and for everyone else. He also saw greatness in other people, wanted it just as badly for them, even when they did not want it bad enough for themselves. Life, to him, was something you had to live to its fullest potential. I met Mac a few times. We didn't have a close relationship, though I have no doubt that between our mutual friends and my profile as a writer, he was aware of me in some regard. He was complimentary when I reviewed his second album for Vibe, which I appreciated, especially because it wasn't the most flattering review. And since he seemed to have a long career ahead of him, I always assumed one day I would write something substantial about him. I certainly didn't know it would be this. Working on this book was an unbelievable challenge. Mac was an endlessly fascinating character, someone whose perspective on life interested me as much as his art. He seemed to have grown up in public and was open about many of his struggles. But when he died on September 7th, 2018, I, like many others, felt it was a terrible tragedy. He had just released the best album of his career, Swimming, and there were still so many questions unanswered. Still, while I thought I was familiar with his story, it wasn't until I began traveling back and forth to Pittsburgh, spending time walking the very same streets he grew up on, and talking to his close friends, that so much of this book started to come together. Even then, though, it was difficult. The pain of having lost him was still so raw for many, and the challenge of asking people questions was something that I, for one of the first times in my life, had moral concerns about. Too soon, I seemed to keep telling myself, it's too soon. But then I noticed something. Despite what my inner voice was telling me, the people I had reached out to for interviews kept wanting to talk. The pain of losing their friend, Mac Miller, was still fresh, but they wanted to share. They had all these memories, all these experiences, all this life that they had lived with him. Not all of it was good. Some of it was bad. And of course, some of it existed in that vast space in between. However, the thing that really drove home how important this book was to write, how essential this book was to write, came on the one-year anniversary of Malcolm's passing. That night, there was a party held in his honor. It was in Pittsburgh, and his longtime DJ, Clockwork, was manning the decks. All proceeds were being donated to the Mac Miller Fund, a charity that supports programming, resources, and opportunities to youth from underserved communities, helping them recognize their full potential through exploration in the arts and community building. After spending the duration of the party inside the venue, enjoying the music, as one is wont to do, I ventured outside and began interviewing many of Mac's fans. These were Mac heads, as they are colloquially known, some new, some old, but all of them sharing between them an undying passion for Mac Miller and his art. Perhaps because of the date, it being the anniversary of his death, emotions were running high, and the stories being shared move me to such a degree that, till this day, still reverberate. These were stories about how Mac's music had saved their lives, how at their lowest moments, when they felt that they were at the end of their rope, they heard his voice, something he said, something he too seemed to be going through, and felt a sudden urge to keep on living. I too knew what those moments felt like, and I too knew what it felt like to receive a sign. I made the decision that night that I would continue working on this book, writing this book, finishing this book, and ultimately publishing this book, because I knew what stories and biographies did for me once, how, even in the moments when they became uncomfortable, they provided a third dimension of understanding about the lives and times of whomever in that moment I was reading about. That understanding brought so much to my life, and helped me in times of need just as, I know, Mac Miller's music had done for other people. A quick note, before you move on to the story itself, let it also be known that this book was written without the participation of Mac Miller's family and estate. With respect to their grieving process, they were approached very early on with the hope that, at least on my behalf, they would ultimately contribute. They opted not to, and I respected that. Nevertheless, many people close to Mac chose to participate, and I appreciate them for it. So, although as the author, my name is on the cover, this book is not for me. This book is for you. You are a Mac Miller fan, or you are a music fan, or maybe you are simply an inquisitive person who wants to read more about a dynamic individual. Know this. Mac Miller was a complex guy, a rapper who spent his life using his art to explore the space between his own madness and genius. All the while, he battled untamable forces inside him that were beyond his control. Now, we may not all be mad geniuses, but on that last note, I'm certain many can relate. Paul Cantor, 3:14 a.m., August 10th, 2021. Prologue. On May 17th, 2018, Mac Miller was at a bar. He was out with friends, knocking back a few drinks. To him, it may have seemed like just another day, but to the public, Mac at a bar was odd. A year earlier, he would not have been there. A year earlier, things were different. Back then, he was in a good place. He was dating one of the most famous singers in the world, Ariana Grande, and he was happy. The Divine Feminine, his fourth album, released in the fall of 2016, had been well received, and he had just performed at Coachella, a career highlight. Most importantly, though, after years of substance abuse, that part of his life was behind him. "It's amazing," he said. "I am actually completely sober for the first time." This was a revelation. For much of his career, it seemed, he had been under the influence of one substance or another. But he always appeared to have things under control. "He did drugs," a longtime fan who got to know him socially told me. "But it wasn't an addiction. It was a lifestyle." The lifestyle had brought him tremendous success. At the time, he had released 4 studio albums, numerous mixtapes, and countless collaborations, earning him worldwide fame, millions of dollars, and a legion of diehard fans. He had started independently with Rostrum Records, then moved to a major label, Warner Brothers, inking a $10 million deal. But success hadn't come easy. Hailing from Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, he was a white rapper in a traditionally black musical genre. Respect wasn't given, it had to be earned, and it took work. Years of pounding the pavement, years of nonstop touring, and years of releasing music, all in a quest to be taken seriously. When he finally achieved a modicum of respectability, arguably around 2013, after the release of his second album, he struggled to adapt. "Being famous used to just defeat me," he said. "I wouldn't leave my house because I was worried about someone being like, 'Oh, are you Mac Miller?' And then the rest of the night, I couldn't be myself." If he was uncomfortable with fame, dating Ariana, a paparazzi magnet, was unlikely to have helped. A former Nickelodeon star, she'd parlayed her TV fame into a pop music career, notching multiple hits along the way. Like Mac, she had a passionate fan base who obsessed over her every move. Their fans seemed genuinely supportive of their relationship, though, and the pair kept up appearances. They performed at each other's shows, were spotted on each other's social media accounts, and showed up at events. For a year and a half, things seemed to be good. Until, well, they weren't. On May 9th, 2018, the celebrity industrial complex was shaken up when Ariana announced, via Instagram story, that she and Mac had broken up. For his part, Mac remained mum, offering no public comments. But within days, Ariana was rumored to have moved on, dating SNL comedian Pete Davidson. By the time the 17th had rolled around, the day Mac sat at that bar, a week had gone by, a week in which gossip columns went crazy, speculating about Ariana and Pete's new relationship, but the budding couple doing little to dispel the rumors. Instead, they simply stirred the pot, flirting the way their generation did best, by liking each other's old photos on Instagram and posting pics of their matching tattoos. Had Mac seen this? It was difficult to tell. Though he was an extremely online person, active on Twitter, Instagram, Facebook, even Vine when it was popping. He was also prone to reading negative comments about himself online, which affected him deeply. Then again, it was also possible he hadn't seen it at all. Regardless, Mac was at the bar downing drinks. It is not clear what he drank. Maybe Knob Creek, Jameson, Remy Martin, or Hennessy, all brands he was fond of. It is possible, based on information revealed later, that he had more in his system than alcohol. But as the night grew darker and the spring cold came in, as it does in LA, where the wind bites the skin when it rolls off the Pacific, it was time to roll. The bar was not far from his house. He would later tell his longtime DJ, Clockwork, that it was mad close. So close, in fact, that he saw no problem with leaving that bar with his car keys in hand and putting those keys into the ignition of his white 2014 Mercedes G63 AMG. The G-Wagon, as it is colloquially known, and doing something they tell you not to do when you've been drinking, let alone drinking the way Mac was known to drink. He got into the car with two passengers and tried to drive his drunk ass home. Around 1 a.m., as he got closer to his house, he rounded a bend. He had come around this bend countless times before, but this time, things were different. "Something just told me to floor it," he told Clockwork. He pressed his foot down on the gas. All eight cylinders fired. 544 horsepower of German steel booming around the corner. 0 to 60 in 5 seconds. 4 seconds. 3 seconds. 2 seconds. Boom. Into the curb, Mac crashed. The car spinning back onto the other side of the road, up over the opposite curb, right into a telephone pole. The telephone pole then cracked, collapsing in a heap against some trees. Mac Miller opened the driver's side door of the G-Wagon, and out into the darkness he went. Through a fence he dashed, escaping, only to be arrested in his house hours later, charged with driving under the influence and a hit and run. After posting $15,000 bail, he was released the next day. The rapper Bun B, a friend and mentor, called him after the accident became headline news. "I'm all right, Unc," Mac said. "It was just a rough day." "If you need to talk to somebody about what's going on," Bun said. "Nah, OG. I promise I'm good," Mac said. Bun took him at his word. So did other people who spoke to him then. "At that point, there's really not much more that you can do," Bun said. "I know that there was this concerted effort to help him fight his demons, trying to help him deal with what he was dealing with. And when people are fighting addiction, it's always easy to put on the public face like, 'Nah, man, I'm good. I'm working on it. I'm addressing it.' You can say everything that you want people to hear you say. You think it will stop them from asking you about it, and then go right back to whatever it is that you told them that you weren't doing." The crash seemed out of character, though. Perhaps it was a sign. Just over a week after the crash, while still at work on the album that would become Swimming, he would sit in the backyard of his house in Brentwood, staring out at the mountains, the great big sky above, and the row of houses built below. On most mornings, the scene brought him great tranquility. Bro, what happened? Clockwork asked him. What happened with the accident? Max sucked on a cigarette. He looked away, failing to make eye contact. I don't know why I did it, he said. I don't know what the fuck I was thinking. He took another drag. Luckily, we hit that tree, and the tree stopped us from going down the hill. He bounced his knee against his hand. He seemed nervous now, hitting the cigarette harder and faster. I don't know, man. Then there was a pause, something said without saying it. Mac looked out further, searching. You ever feel invincible? He said. More silence. I just felt invincible. 1. In Point Breeze, Pittsburgh, the leafy streets are clean, the air quiet and peaceful. Stately homes dot neat, well-manicured blocks. The most visible hardship here, you'd think, is the never-ending saga of maintaining one's lawn. This neighborhood is filled with children and dogs, one resident told me. Everyone wants to live in Point Breeze. Some of the wealthiest people in the history of the United States live there, said Arthur Pitt, a Point Breeze native who, depending on whom you're talking to, can lay claim to having been the one to discover Mac Miller. It fluctuates from the wealthier side. If you cross the main avenue, it's not as wealthy. It's a mix. Point Breeze is an interesting place. Indeed it is. Long before the Pulitzer Prize-winning writer Annie Dillard's memoir about Point Breeze, An American Childhood, published in 1987, detailing her coming of age in the Pittsburgh suburb in the 1950s, and wrestling with the neighborhood's complicated legacy. And long before doctors, lawyers, and politicians, today's upper middle class called it home, Point Breeze was just a bunch of trees in the midst of a great, unsettled wilderness. Historians traced its post-Native American history to 1758, when it was settled by Europeans. Back then, the neighborhood was neither breezy nor pointy, but there was a hotel, the Point Breeze Hotel, that stood at the center of present-day Fifth and Penn Avenues. Some 200 years ago, a traveler from a distant land, perhaps New York or Philadelphia, might have been riding along in their pimped-out stagecoach. They'd be tired. A trip west could take literally months. And so they'd stop, have a hearty meal, catch some Z's, then wake to the sound of birdsong in the morning before continuing on their journey. In those days, the only way through Point Breeze was the Greensburg Pike, a Native American trail paved in the early 19th century. At once rustic and remote, it wasn't long after it got paved that the Pittsburgh gentry discovered the area. They saw it as a refuge from the hustle and bustle of the city rapidly growing around it. Among the esteemed folks who landed in Point Breeze was Judge William Wilkins. The son of a captain in the American Revolution, Wilkins held many positions of high social importance. He was president of the Bank of Pittsburgh, a member of the House of Representatives, a senator, congressman, secretary of war, even the U.S. minister to Russia. In his day, he was kind of a big deal. Wilkins liked Point Breeze, and in 1835, he built himself a grand, MTV Cribs-style house there. This would be a mansion, a big, sprawling thing fashioned in the Greek Revival style, with four Georgian columns fronting a stately entrance, surrounded by 650 acres of open land. A house such as this would not do with just an address. It needed to be more than that, for it was more than that. It was a big home surrounded by woods. Wilkins dubbed it Homewood. At Homewood, Wilkins hosted important people. Daniel Webster, Henry Clay, even the 7th Vice President of the United States, John Calhoun, all came by the mansion to eat and chit-chat. Politics as usual. All the while, the world outside Homewood, outside of Point Breeze, was rapidly changing. America was a young country, and Pittsburgh was a young city, but it was already proving to be one of the most important locations in the Union. Pittsburgh sat at the confluence of the Allegheny and Monongahela rivers, which met and became the Ohio River, then flowed 981 miles southwest to Cairo, Illinois, where it connected with the Mississippi. In the early 1800s, the big business in Pittsburgh was boats, because railroads were still in their infancy, and traveling on the rivers was how people got around. To wit, it was from Pittsburgh, not St. Louis, as it's commonly thought, that Lewis and Clark departed on their landmark 8,000-mile expedition exploring the territories obtained by the United States from France in the Louisiana Purchase. The legendary explorers floated down the Ohio River to Missouri, and from there they went on to discover the rest of the country. Because of this, Pittsburgh in the 1800s was known as the gateway to the West. All of America was soon to head in that direction. Through Pittsburgh is how they would get there. But Pittsburgh also had other things working in its favor, like a wealth of natural resources. In the late 1700s, for example, large coal deposits were discovered a few miles west of Point Breeze, across the Ohio River, in a neighborhood largely settled by German immigrants called Mount Washington. Coal had many uses and led to the development of a variety of industries. It could be used for fuel, and with fuel, there was a world of opportunity. All around the city, factories and foundries were being built. Iron, brass, tin, glass, textiles, furniture, booze, even oil refinery. If it could be made, Pittsburgh would make it. Along with the boom in industry came a boom in population. Immigrants arrived. Welsh, Scottish, German, Irish, and others. Many of them would work in the factories, while the veterans of the Revolutionary War were literally handed plots of land. As for black people, the year 1780 saw enslavement abolished in Pennsylvania, though it remained in another form, indentured servitude, which held back former enslaved people and the children of enslaved people from taking part in the great Pittsburgh land grab. Perhaps the most famous of the Pittsburgh strivers was Andrew Carnegie. Carnegie was born in Scotland, but early in his life, after his parents had fallen on hard times, they borrowed money and in 1848 moved with Andrew to Pennsylvania. They took up residence in Slabtown, a noisy, overcrowded immigrant community that came with only the finest accoutrements. No natural gas, no water, streets that remained cloaked in darkness at night, and where, at all times of day, one would encounter wild hogs and dogs roaming free. There was also little concern for the conditions the factories created. The smoke permeated and penetrated everything, Carnegie wrote. If you washed your face and hands, they were as dirty as ever in an hour. The soot gathered in the hair and irritated the skin, and for a time, life was more or less miserable. Carnegie was not overly educated, having ended his studies around the time he immigrated, but was industrious and hardworking. As a youth, he worked in a cotton factory, then got a job as a messenger. It was through this job that he met Thomas A. Scott, president of Pennsylvania Railroad, who took him on as his secretary, paying him $35 a month. It was at this job, now with more money, that he began investing, taking up interests in coal, iron, and oil. When the Civil War broke out, demand increased for iron, helping Carnegie turn a profit. When the war finally ended, he turned his interest to iron almost exclusively, resigning from the Pennsylvania Railroad to start the Keystone Bridge Company in 1865, making a small fortune in contracts to build iron bridges in place of the more common wooden ones. But by then, Carnegie had already moved up in the world, living with his family, far from the grime and pollution that hung like a thick cloud over the city, in a house on Homewood Street, just a stone's throw from Judge William Wilkins, which he'd purchased in 1862. In his early 30s, having made enough money to no longer be poor, but still lacking in some sense the luxuries that wealth could afford, Carnegie wrote himself a memo. During his lifetime, it was never shared, and it was only after his death, when his wife donated it to the New York Public Library, that it became public. The memo detailed Carnegie's plans to retire at age 35. At that point, he would aim to become a learned, sophisticated man. And by 40, his mind flush with all the literary knowledge he'd since then consumed, he'd move, in his newly cosmopolitan life, to London, he thought, and devote himself to more serious matters. Maybe he'd run a newspaper, all the while putting his money to good use, helping those who were less fortunate. To continue much longer overwhelmed by business cares, and with most of my thoughts wholly upon the way to make more money in the shortest time, must degrade me beyond hope of permanent recovery, he wrote. The pursuit of money, it seemed, was in all it was cracked up to be. But early retirement never came. A few years later, Carnegie began turning iron into steel, which in turn led him to buy up steel mills. In the late 1800s, he formed Carnegie Steel Company, and in 1901 sold it at the behest of J.P. Morgan to U.S. Steel, netting him $226 million, an amount worth more than $7 billion today. Among Carnegie's partners in the steel business was Henry Clay Frick, whose acquaintance he made while Frick was honeymooning with his wife in New York. Despite a 25-year difference in age, the two became fast friends. Frick, too, was an industrialist, but his main trade was coke. Not the white stuff, but what became of baking coal in a brick beehive oven, and which was a key component in the manufacture of steel. According to R.J. Gangwer, the editor at Carnegie Magazine, Frick adroitly took control of the coal fields of Connellsville in the 1870s and expanded his control of mining and coking operations until he became a millionaire by the age of 30. The finest metallurgical coke in the world was his to sell, and he sold it to Carnegie Steel, eventually becoming a partner in that firm as well as remaining the king of coke. At Carnegie Steel, Frick rose to become chief executive, all the while serving in a kind of Tom Hagen role to Don Andrew. But over time, after fortunes were made many times over, the two had a falling out. Carnegie tried forcing Frick from the company, so Frick raised the price of his coke. Carnegie balked and fired him. In turn, Frick tried kicking Carnegie's ass. Instead, he had to settle for a good old-fashioned lawsuit, said to be, at that time at least, the largest in American history. Frick won the lawsuit and pocketed $31 million. The two men would remain bitter enemies for the rest of their lives, though they continued to be neighbors, as Frick, too, called Point Breeze his home. From 1882 to 1905, he lived along with his family in a 22-room mansion called the Clayton, which he purchased for $25,000 and where he received visitors, among them titans of industry, politicians, and other members of the upper crust. In fact, in 1902, as part of an executive committee looking to bring the president to Pittsburgh, Henry Clay Frick sent an invite to Theodore Roosevelt. Roosevelt accepted and soon traveled to the city, where he gave a speech at Schenley Park to a crowd of more than 750,000 people. Afterward, in lieu of returning to Washington, he departed for the Clayton, where he dined with the Fricks. Such was the appeal of the Fricks' home, and such was the allure of Point Breeze. Presidents walked its streets. When Frick died, nearly 20 years later, he left much of his wealth to be used for the public good, including the home and the land that would become Frick Park, the largest municipal park in all of Pittsburgh. As the 20th century progressed, the robber barons who made their mark in Pittsburgh would leave for elsewhere, like New York City. And before long, the era of great wealth they'd brought to American life would decline. The mansions that for 100 years once stood in Point Breeze would be, in many instances, demolished. The streets would be built up and expanded as the neighborhoods around it, like East Liberty, Squirrel Hill, and Shadyside, grew. But the legacy of achievement would forever remain in Point Breeze. In the decades after Frick and Carnegie were long gone, in the years when Judge William Wilkins's last name would be known only to historians, the people in Point Breeze would, unknowingly, walk in their image. In a city where the cost of living was, compared with the rest of the United States, relatively low, the neighborhood would remain, unlike much of Pittsburgh proper, affluent and aspirational. In Point Breeze, politicians, artists, educators, scientists, doctors, and lawyers, the best and the brightest, came to live. The Steel City could boom and bust as it so famously did throughout the second half of the 1900s. But in Point Breeze, a dependable, upper-middle-class life known as the American Dream was attainable. And that was the world into which, decades later, one young boy was born. 2. Malcolm McCormick was born at 8:46 a.m. on January 19, 1992. He was exactly 8 pounds, and from that day on, it seemed he was destined to become the center of attention. His mother, Karen, was a photographer by trade. One of her clients was University of Pittsburgh Medical Center, and when the hospital needed a face for one of its billboards, "We need a cute kid," they said. Malcolm said his mother thought, "Well, I've got one right here." And that's how, at the age of 5, not yet even able to tie his own shoes, Malcolm McCormick's cherubic face ended up on a billboard. He had a thermometer in his mouth, Karen said in an interview with Complex. All his friends that were in preschool would see it, because it was on the highway coming back from the airport. They'd say, "Is Malcolm sick?" The house he grew up in Point Breeze, was full of art and music. Karen's photography work kept her busy, and his dad, Mark, was an architect. He served on the city's art commission and ran his own firm, which was prominent in the redevelopment of many landmarks in and around Pittsburgh. But Mark was not a Pittsburgh native. In fact, he had grown up in Silver Lake, Ohio, an affluent suburb of Akron. In the early 70s, he graduated from Miami University of Ohio with a dual degree in psychology and philosophy. After some years working as a carpenter in Denver, Colorado, he found his way back to school and graduated with a master's degree in architecture in 1979. In Denver, Mark quickly found employment with the firm Barker, Rinker, Seacat, and Partners. In 1984, he became a partner, but it wasn't long before he was on the move again, this time to Pennsylvania. By then, he had met Karen, who had grown up in Pittsburgh, and in 1986, they were married. Karen's father was an engineer, her mother a homemaker, and she went to school in Massachusetts, Boston University, and Emerson College, specifically, where she studied English and art history. Public records reveal the 2 years after getting married, with Mark working as the city architect of Pittsburgh, they bought a house in Point Breeze on Rosemary Road. Built in 1855, the four-bedroom house was a shade under 2,500 square feet. Not overly large, but perhaps just the right size, because not long afterward, in 1988, Karen gave birth. The family's first son was named Miller, perhaps for his maternal grandmother, Marcia, who was born Marcia Miller before changing her last name to that of her first husband, William Ted Myers, the last name Karen appears to have taken and kept upon marrying Mark, and later Weiss for her second husband, Mickey Weiss. In the early 90s, the McCormicks were a prosperous bunch. Mark had, by then, left his city job and gone back into the private sector, buying out his previous employer, Oliver Design Group. When Malcolm arrived in 1992, one of Mark's big projects was redesigning the Heinz 57 Center, an historic building formerly housing Gimbel's flagship department store, rechristened under the corporate banner of German ketchup entrepreneur and one-time Point Breeze resident, Henry J. Heinz. For the most part, Malcolm's childhood was idyllic. In 1998, the family moved a few blocks to a new house, which was larger, 5 bedrooms. Things were going well. A few years earlier, Mark had completed a big project, the redevelopment of the public library in Mount Lebanon, a Pittsburgh suburb. The work was significant. It involved stripping the library's original structure, built in 1965, to its bones, then building it back up again, making it bigger, more than doubling it from 13,000 square feet to 26,500, and filling it with natural light. Ample space was dedicated for reading and individual study. "We love the light," Cynthia Ritchie, the library's director, said at the time. "The building is spacious, but there are nooks for reading. I also like the pitched and beamed roof. This is nirvana for us." Another big design plus was room for computers, 62 of them, without sacrificing space for books and library stacks. In fact, now there was even more room for books. "We still have books," Ritchie said. "Libraries call them the cockroaches of civilization. You can't get rid of them. I don't think they will ever disappear." Upon its completion, the former commissioner of Mount Lebanon, Barbara Logan, said of Mark's firm, "You have won much deserved recognition, and a standard of quality has been established for the community." The project netted Mark a Design Excellence Award from the Pittsburgh chapter of the American Institute of Architects. Mark and Karen didn't necessarily push their kids to be creative, but it wasn't a stretch that they would be. "I'm a photographer, and my husband's an architect," Karen told Complex. "There's a lot of genetic disposition towards creativity." Karen and Mark were baby boomers, part of the post-hippie generation that defined so much of American life in the second half of the 20th century. Music, art, culture, they were into it all. When the kids were young, they took them to jazz concerts in the park. At home, they hipped the boys to the music of their youth and anything else that caught their ears. "My dad plays guitar," Malcolm said, "and my mom always had music blasting in the house. All kinds of music, everything from the Talking Heads to Lauryn Hill to Aretha Franklin. Crazy stuff. So I was like, instantly into music." Malcolm was particularly keen on the Beatles, whose album Sgt. Pepper's Lonely Hearts Club Band would, over time, become one of his favorites. Malcolm loved the band so much that he got 2 Beatles tattoos, John Lennon on his right forearm and the word Imagine on his right inner bicep. "I love what the Beatles represent," Malcolm would say many years after the band's music had been seared into his memory. I love all the shit when they started getting really weird. I kind of identify with them, not in massiveness, but in their journey. As for Lennon and that tattoo, he flat out believed the man from Liverpool was the second coming of the Messiah. "He's Jesus," he said. "John Lennon is my favorite." Then there was Dylan. His dad loved Bob Dylan so much that he brought the boys to see Dylan on his never-ending tour when Malcolm was still a child. The family's tickets were general admission, but Malcolm was so entranced by the performance that he snuck down to the front row where he could take it all in. And back at the house, it wasn't uncommon to find Mark hanging out with the kids, guitar in his hip, singing and strumming one of Dylan's tunes. "It all helped me see that you didn't need a whole lot of things to make an impact," Malcolm said. "Sometimes you just need a guy and a guitar speaking his own truths." But it was more than Dylan and his truth that affected Malcolm. It was Dylan's voice, that nasal, mid-range drone. Whether he was belting out his material or singing low and controlled, if Dylan's music was playing, you could tell it was him. Dylan's voice was as much a part of his act as the guitar or harmonica. "Bob Dylan is someone who had a voice that was unlike anyone else's," Malcolm said. "He wasn't hitting the wildest falsetto runs. He just put his soul in it." Years later, Malcolm would seek to emulate this. "When I sing, it's a very vulnerable state," he said. "Very raw. It's me not worrying about where I fall on the spectrum of good singing, and more like how my voice is my instrument." But that was yet to come. Still a kid, Malcolm exuded a natural charisma. In home videos and photos, friends aren't just embraced. They're hugged as if life depends on it. Many people who knew Malcolm as a child say that he radiated happiness. Take one particular video, where he raps the lyrics to the Sugar Hill Gang's Rapper's Delight. He delivers the lyrics with a wry smile, his eyes wide and teeth big, hair falling just above his ears. In her interview with Complex, Karen recalled that Malcolm had always been magnetic, relishing any opportunity to put on a show. Dylan Reynolds met Malcolm when he was 5 at a Little League game. Malcolm's face was painted like Spider-Man, and he was surrounded by other kids. Even then, he was the center of attention. The pair became fast friends and were soon sleeping over at each other's houses regularly. In an article for nextpittsburgh.com, Reynolds remembered a particular moment back when they played youth football together. "Our coach told us that on defense, we should all try to touch the ball carrier. This was supposed to teach us how to be involved in a play and follow through until the play was over." Malcolm, who was the littlest guy on the field, took this literally and would often be the last one to jump on the dog pile, to which the announcer would say, "Mac attack." He always wanted to be involved in the action. He hated to be left out. Other friends who played youth sports remembered him spending more time messing around than actually playing the game. For Malcolm, the real action wasn't on the field. It was off of it. You have those guys in the dugout that are making everyone laugh and are always grabbing people's attention, probably taking people's attention away from the game, said Ben Cohen, who played with Malcolm in a baseball league in nearby Squirrel Hill, the neighborhood famous for being the home of Mr. Rogers. He was a good athlete, but a better entertainer. Malcolm was interested in music as soon as he was old enough to recognize it. He was always dancing around the house. If it had a beat, he'd move to it. Then, around the age of 5 or 6 years old, things got turned up a notch. It was the holiday season, and he wasn't really looking forward to another pair of socks. He told his parents that he wanted to make music. Like, for real. So, that year, on one of Hanukkah's 8 nights, he unwrapped a gift and found something life-altering staring back at him. A brand new keyboard. I hooked that thing up and never stopped playing it, he said. Next came piano lessons. Malcolm took to it. Still, he had to add his own twist. At piano recitals, I would never play Beethoven or Mozart. I would play my own shit, he said, which wasn't as good as Beethoven or Mozart, but you had to respect the effort. Then there was that bellwether of every child's upbringing, religion. Mom was Jewish and Dad was Catholic. For Malcolm, like many kids of interfaith marriages, this complicated things. His sense of identity was in flux and was shaped by the world around him. Early on, he attended Catholic schools. First, it was elementary at St. Peter and Paul. After that, middle school at St. Bede, where the philosophy espoused is that each child is a unique human being endowed by God with special gifts, and where learnings are peppered with Roman Catholic influences with a focus on faith, family, community, love, and service. The goal, in the end, was to model Christ-like behaviors through actions and words. But Malcolm also went to Hebrew school. At 13, he had his bar mitzvah at Rodef Shalom, an historic synagogue with the distinguished privilege of being the oldest Jewish congregation in western Pennsylvania. And he spent many summers at the Emma Kaufman camp, a Jewish sleepaway camp near Morgantown, West Virginia, where at night he slept in a dorm and during the day he engaged in summery activities, barn fires and sing-alongs, swimming, water skiing, canoeing, horseback riding, and arts and crafts. It was your typical summer jam. Malcolm made many close friends at the camp and was influenced by its outings. Daily trips where the kids boarded a yellow school bus, then traveled to places like Cincinnati and Washington, D.C. It was a way to break up the monotony of the days spent in the great outdoors, but it also provided an opportunity for Malcolm to entertain his pals, like in a video taken when Malcolm was a teenager, where he sits on the bus with his friends. Dressed in togas, their fitted caps twisted backward, the scene has all the gravitas of a frat house. The togas. Quad five, homie, Malcolm shouts. And the kids start shouting back, toga, toga, toga. Then he quiets them down. Do the beat. Sitting across from Malcolm, a kid begins beatboxing. Like a comic version of 8 Mile, Malcolm smiles, his braces tight against his big white teeth. He pushes his medium-length hair back, fixes the blue toga resting against his white tank top, his eyes wide. He jumps in. On the bus sitting here in a toga. The rhyme is otherwise inoffensive. Just a kid saying things to impress his friends on a hot summer day. It is hardly the stuff from which deep meaning could be extracted. Though the lyric, I spit a few lines and they act like it's a crime, suggests something unspoken at play. Malcolm attended the Emma Kaufman camp until he was 15. On weekends, he'd perform at the camp's Shabbat talent shows. People say you gotta start at Shabbat concert, Sam Bloom, a former camp director, told the Jewish Chronicle. If it wasn't, it was darn close to where it began. He did more than rap at these concerts. Jeremy Goldman, another former camp director, told the Chronicle that he remembered telling Malcolm his favorite song was Send Me On My Way by Rusted Root. And when Saturday night came, sure enough, there was Malcolm with the guitar, belting out the song. At 13 years old, he was cooler than anyone I had ever met, and I was 31 at the time, Goldman said. Whenever it was his turn to do his act, he brought the house down. But Malcolm never made much of a real fuss about Judaism or Christianity. On a song titled SDS, released in 2013, he rapped that he was a Jewish Buddhist trying to consume the views of Christianity. More than just a clever boast, it seemed to be a summary of his spiritual life. Judaism, which he would later mine for both comedic and creative effect, was just another footnote in the countless things that made him who he was. Fans seized on his Judaism, though. In an early interview, when told people were calling him the greatest Jewish rapper of all time, he chuckled. "I'm Jewish. That's how I was raised. I had a bar mitzvah," he said. "But I'm not a very religious person. So it's humorous to me when people do this big Jewish rapper thing. This is a world filled with so much variety of cultures. Every time something different is out, it's good. Because then it's just like, oh, a Jewish rapper. I didn't think there could be a Jewish rapper. But there could be any kind of rapper. Religion has nothing to do with that." You see, people were billing him as a Jewish rapper when he was just a rapper who happened to be Jewish. Were they confused? Perhaps, but then Malcolm wore Judaism literally on his sleeve. On his upper left arm, he had a tattoo, the Jewish symbol of a chai. In Judaism, the chai is made up of two letters, chet and yod. Together, they are said to mean alive or living. The chai commemorates life. He got the tattoo for two reasons. He wanted it to remind him who he was, a Jew, but also to remember one crucial thing, that in life, no moment was greater than any other. To be alive, breathing, that was a beautiful thing. Life was something he hoped to never take for granted. 3. Life in Point Breeze was peachy. It was a front porch community where neighbors kept tabs on other people's kids and where, when an adult suspected someone from the other side, like, say, neighboring Homewood, just across Penn Avenue, of casing the place, they walked right over and let them know they were being watched, then walked them out of the neighborhood, assuming they hadn't already taken the hint. Arguably the most liberal part of town, its houses were filled with academics and artists, and its relative safety and progressive politics came with its own set of problems, namely the long leash some parents gave their kids. In the neighborhood, Malcolm was one of many kids who stayed out of trouble, but tested the limits. Will Calson lived not far from Malcolm, in nearby Squirrel Hill. "I would be in Point Breeze all the time, playing basketball, playing football," Calson said. Malcolm would always be around. He was just this little kid that ran around the neighborhood. He said things that he shouldn't have been saying at his age, and you, like, remembered him. They first met on the basketball court at Sterrett Middle School, down the street from Malcolm's home, right across from Frick Park. "He came down on the court and was trying to play with us. He must have been 11 years old. And so he came over, and he was, like, way smaller. I mean, we were in middle school, and he was in elementary school." After Malcolm hooped for a little bit, the game came to its end. The boys meandered around the court. That was when Malcolm cut in. "What you doing tonight?" The boys looked at one another, confused. What could this little kid care about what they were up to? "I don't know," Calson said. "What are you doing tonight?" Malcolm didn't miss a beat. "I'm gonna go smoke some blunts," he said. "Yeah, that's right. I'm gonna go smoke some blunts with these bitches." In the neighborhood, it wasn't uncommon for kids to begin smoking weed by 13 or 14 years of age. Malcolm began even earlier. He started with cigarettes in the third grade. Then, 2 years later, when he was 10, came weed. Now, if Malcolm seemed a bit bold, well, he was a colorful kid and was already knee-deep into hip-hop, rife with its adult themes. The first rap album he ever listened to was Outkast's Sequemini, which he had picked up rifling through his brother's CD collection. To him, the album served as a kind of North Star. "That's the bar for me. It's my guiding light," he said. "I heard it when I was super young. My brother had it, and the cover was just so unbelievable that I grabbed it. I remember locking myself in my grandma's guest room and listening to it on repeat all day. Being that young and having an idea of what I thought music should be, then hearing Aquemini completely shifted things. The thing that he loved about Aquemini was that it had a central theme. The subject matter itself was wide-ranging, but it had a specific tone, a real sound. Its tracks brim with live instrumentation and an experimental, trippy vibe. Southern rap was still in its infancy, and the album, released in 1998, cut against the grain. It wasn't Wu-Tang, Bad Boy, Rough Riders, or Rockefeller. It was Outkast, and it was art. "It's a whole, complete album, not just a collection of songs," he said. One track he loved was Hold On, Be Strong, the album's intro. On it, singer Tony Hightower gently repeats the lyrics, "Hold on, be strong," over an ethereal guitar lick and plaintive kalimba, played by group member Andre 3000 himself. "It makes me feel like I'm in water," Malcolm said, which is my favorite feeling. When he wasn't spacing out to Outkast, he was jamming to indie rock, stuff like Jack Johnson, Bright Eyes, and Dave Matthews, among other eclectic interests. One of my last middle school memories is of him with long, curly hair with a guitar under his arm while singing some Dave Matthews song to a girl at our school, James Rudolph, a fellow student at St. Bede, recalled. Around his neck was not a diamond-encrusted pendant, no hip-hop bling. I even think he was wearing a puka-shell necklace, those bead necklaces that were a hallmark of the early 2000s, while doing it. The look fit with his MO. His original goal, in fact, was to be more of a singer-songwriter. When he was going through puberty, he was going really hard on the guitar, Jimmy Merton, one of his closest friends, told Complex. He wanted to be a singer-songwriter. He played in bands, even competed in some local competitions. At one battle of the bands in 2004, at the Jewish Community Center, he played the acoustic guitar and sang. People who were there remember it being an impressive little performance. Maybe there was a future in this. He could grow up and have a rock career. He could play guitar in a jam band, tour college campuses, and make a killing. "I thought I was gonna be like a G-Love type of person," he would later say. "That's what I thought I was gonna do." But the band dream got put on hold. People weren't enthused about his voice and acquired taste, and before long, he was finding other ways to express himself. 4. Growing up, Malcolm had a diverse group of friends. On the one hand, the nice Jewish boys he went to camp with in West Virginia. On the other, his pals from Point Breeze and its surrounding neighborhoods. One of his best friends was Derek Green. Derek's mom, Marina, grew up in Pittsburgh. Her dad, Derek's grandfather, was Wesley Posvar, a decorated Air Force veteran and later the chancellor of the University of Pittsburgh. His grandmother was Mildred Miller, a mezzo-soprano with the Metropolitan Opera, who later founded the Opera Theater of Pittsburgh. Derek's mom went to middle school with Malcolm's mom, Karen. When she got married, the family began moving around a lot. His dad was a sports television producer, and every few years his job found him uprooting the whole family to wherever the work went. One year it was New York, the next Maryland, after that Oklahoma, and finally, after many years, the parents got divorced, which is when they moved back to Pittsburgh. It was like, "Oh, I'm gonna reconnect with my old crew. You got kids? I'm gonna bring my kids around your kids," said Derek's older brother, Brian. Malcolm's a year younger than my brother, Derek, so they became super, super close, and he was at our house every weekend, sleeping over or vice versa. Even back then, there was something about Malcolm that made him seem special. "He was very much an old soul," Brian said. As a kid, despite his amount of years on Earth, he felt more in touch with the base elements of human contact and emotion. He could relate to people who were way older than him. When I was in high school, 9th grade, 10th grade, he would be cool with seniors in high school, dapping them up and cutting up with them. He exceeded beyond his years. Plus, he was entertaining. He was very charismatic and funny, Brian said. He was 10 and I was 14, whatever the age difference was, but I still found him hilarious to talk to. He always had a smile on his face. He was almost always laughing. He could brighten up everybody's smile in a room, no matter how old you were. You were either going to laugh at him or laugh with him. Bill Neals was another friend. He went to school with Malcolm's brother, Miller. They were in the same grade, and he, too, would sleep over at Malcolm's house. My first memory of Mac, he was about 10 or 11, Bill said, and we were all laughing in his parents' kitchen. I had just spilled milk out of my nose. The next time their paths crossed, things were a little more tense. It was a weekend, and they were out at the country home of Brian's grandparents in Ligonier, PA, about an hour southeast of Pittsburgh. It's Brian and Bill, a bunch of their high school friends, and Malcolm and Derek, and a bunch of their middle school friends. Bill, for whatever reason, decided to take acid. And we were just fucking tripping our balls out, Bill said. Malcolm and his friends were off in a separate corner of the house, not high on acid, but certainly up to their own unique brand of mischief. We were all leaving the next morning, Bill said, and I was like, broke. But Bill had a BB gun on him, and Malcolm just happened to cross his line of sight. So I go up. I put the gun to Mac's head. Give me your money. Malcolm was scared shitless. I wasn't actually going to hurt him, Bill said. But then he gave it to me, $20 or something. And I was like, all right, cool. And I just left. Malcolm never harbored any ill feelings. That wasn't his style. He was too easygoing and carefree, saw too much of the good in people. He could never hold a grudge. Years later, he showed up at my mom's apartment. He bought some shirt off of me for $20, but he never paid me. And he was like, that's for that. Then there was Tree J. Tree J grew up in Pittsburgh's Hill District, just a 15-minute drive from Malcolm's house, but in many ways a world away. Up there, they sell dope their whole lives. Go to jail, said Tree J. That's all anyone does in the Hill District. I got lucky making it out. It was a mixture of good and bad fortune that led Tree J to that outcome. There was a school across the street from my mom's house, and I got kicked out of that. I was so young, it had to have been something stupid. So my mom sent me to another school, and I got kicked out of there. I was fucking around with the principal's daughter. Not in a sexual way or anything. I was in, like, third grade. I just liked picking on her, I guess. Anyway, the principal gave me the boot. After that, Tree J's mom told him she would be sending him to a much nicer school. He would have to take a bus there, but maybe it'd put him in the right kind of learning environment, around the right kind of people, to set him on a better path. You fuck up again, she told him. I'm just gonna whoop your ass. So Tree J went to St. Bede, one of a handful of black students at a mostly white school. It's the first time I was really around white people, he said. And it was at St. Bede, with its focus on small classes, just 32 students per grade level, where he became close with a pair of white kids. Their names? Jimmy Merton and Derek Green. Like Derek, Jimmy had known Malcolm since he was a child. He had met him at a friend's house around the time he was 8, and they would often play together in the neighborhood. As Tree J began traveling from the Hill District to hang with Derek and Jimmy, he inevitably fell in with the little kid who was always around him. Malcolm would be there, Tree J said. So we became this little group, me, Jimmy, Derek, and Malcolm. I was like the connecting Fred, Malcolm said. The friends spent a lot of time at Derek's house. The house was a relatively carefree kind of place, with little parental supervision. There, they would smoke weed, listen to music. Lil Wayne and Dipset got a lot of play, and generally run amok. Brian's mom's house was basically like, "You could do whatever you wanted there," said Will Carlson, who would frequent the spot when he came home from college. But the freedom had its drawbacks. Malcolm and Derek, who were still relatively young, could keep their shit under control. Derek's older brother, Brian, however, was another story. "I was selling drugs on a very small level," Brian said. "Just weed, and maybe something randomly, like mushrooms. I wasn't trapping on the block or nothing like that." School wasn't of much interest to him, so he dropped out. It wasn't like, "Oh, I'm rich, I don't need to do this," or anything like that, he said. "I was just doing that, and I was like, fuck school." I wasn't looking out for my future at that point. I was just making reckless decisions.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.